Tonight, we are in the desert of southern Jordan, and we are looking for the pillar-tailed scorpion, scorpions in the genus Orthochirus. I've been seeing some here and there for the past couple weeks, and tonight the sky is quite dark, so we should be able to see a few. We have our first Orthochirus down here. And I should have warned you, these are quite small. This is an adult. I'm not usually one to use American measurement units, but these are about the same size as one goat shit. And I'm thinking that maybe one of these little holes could be its burrow. Pillar-tailed scorpion is not only used for this Orthochirus, but rather the entire genus. And morphologically, it's the most noticeable thing about this scorpion. These small little dents that you see on the last two segments of the metasoma are fairly unique to the genus Orthochirus, but not as extreme as on scorpions like Orthochiroides. And there are other similar buthids with the same thing going on with their tail. These little dents are quite a contrast to what most scorpions exhibit morphologically. Most scorpions instead have granulated tails, or ones with small denticles. These also have one of the largest metasoma to mesosoma, or tail to body ratios, across all scorpion species. Not only this, but they're also somewhat unique in how they hold their tail. Most scorpions keep it curled up above their tergites, or behind them, near the ground. But these Orthochirus almost always keep their tail hovering straight just above the body. Lastly, these are quite wide compared to your average scorpion. But despite all of these unique morphological characters, these were unfortunately named after their hands instead. Orthochirus translates from Greek to straight hand, which is not that remarkable at all for these scorpions. We have a Myriopholis macrorhyncha slithering towards me. And that is this hook-nosed worm snake. This Myriopholis is in the family Leptotyphlopidae, which means that it is a species of thread snake. Many Myriopholis species are referred to as worm snakes, including this one. This is also a name that's given to a bunch of random, unrelated snakes around the world, pretty much all fossorial. But I think of all snakes with the name worm snake, these and a couple others are the ones that deserve it most. These are the thinnest snakes here, and as you might imagine, the smallest snakes here as well. In addition to this, these are also the only snakes here that are not colubroids. These live in the flat areas of the desert around here, and unsurprisingly, they don't surface very often either. Like many Samophilus snakes, these do have an enlarged rostral scale, though it is a little bit difficult to see here. It isn't really feasible for me to show you, but these also have what looks like a large overbite. Their bottom jaw is quite small compared to the top. We have a large camel spider racing around down here in this bush. This is a camel spider in the genus Othoes. I would include a full-length clip of it in this video, but I've already made an entire video dedicated to this species. So if you want to see that, of course I will leave a link in the description of this video. The habitat of this camel spider and the Orthochirus that we're looking for are adjacent to one another, so this is a species that I've been encountering while looking for these scorpions. This one is a little bit on the thin side, so hopefully it can catch itself a bug or a lizard tonight. This is a female, and females at their healthiest have quite a plump abdomen, which this one does not. There is a bug in this bush. I'm talking about this one here. This is an Empusa fasciata mantis. And there's actually a second one that's living in the same bush. It is over here, but you can't really see it very well. Hold on, let me take it out. And here it is, our second Empusa fasciata mantis. These are called conehead mantises. And I think this particular species might sometimes be called the fasciated conehead mantis, like its specific epithet. These are found around the Balkans, Crimea, the Caucasus, Turkey, Iran, and the Levant. And I probably missed a region or two in there, but we are at the southern limit of their distribution. Like Empusa pinnata, another species of conehead, these can be pink sometimes. Ordinarily, these are supposed to hatch in July, which is the current month, so I'm not sure how they're so large already. This is about the size that they're supposed to overwinter. But maybe the phenology is a little bit different in southern Jordan, I'm not too sure. Typically, like with other conehead mantises, you see the adults in the spring. This is one of 14 species of mantises that was used in a study on their detectable frequency range. Specifically, this was a study that determined that the frequency used by bats to locate their prey is audible to some mantises. This turned out to be true for this mantis species, meaning that adult males of this species can avert bat predation when they're flying around looking for mates. The sand sheets out here, like the one I am currently walking on, are quite contiguous, but the dunes are not. And it's where the sand meets the rock at the mountainside where we can find these Orthochirus, but the sand sheets don't reach the mountain. So we're looking for dunes, and they're very segmented or broken off from one another. So most of the night is spent walking around looking for the next suitable habitat piece. We have our second Orthochirus sitting down here in the bushes. This little one, I don't know if you can tell, but this one is actually missing a foot. Since the beginning of this video, I've been calling these scorpions by their genus name, Orthochirus, but not by the species, and that is because the ones in this area are unresolved. And that could mean one of two things. First, it could be undescribed, or second, it's just unassigned. If it is just an unassigned species, it's worth noting that Orthochirus negibensis is in the west, and Orthochirus inesi is in the east. Both of these scorpions I just mentioned are quite similar to the one that we're looking at right now. They're nearly black, and they have these bicolor legs and pedipalps, fading to a lighter color distally. In fact, most other Orthochirus are not too dissimilar from this kind of pattern. The vast majority are dark brown or black, with some kind of discoloration in the legs and the pedipalps. But while many Orthochirus do look quite similar, it's still a very diverse genus for scorpion standards. It contains over 50 species, making it one of the most diverse genera in the most diverse family of scorpions, Buthidae, otherwise known as the arrow-breasted scorpions. It looks like this one isn't going to start eating until I turn my light off, so I think we're going to leave this one alone now. We have a Ptyodactylus hasselquisti up here on the rock. I'm going to have to get it with both hands because I don't want it to lose its tail. This is the yellow fan-fingered gecko, and it's a species that's mostly associated with the Red Sea, but it also ranges into Sudan, further into Arabia, and as far south as the Gulf of Aden. Along with the Sinai fan-fingered gecko, these are quite common around the rock walls here, which is quite puzzling to me considering the apparent lack of insects that are crawling around on these walls. And that gecko that I just mentioned, the Sinai fan-fingered gecko, used to be a synonym of Ptyodactylus hasselquisti. And the both of them, just like other Ptyodactylus species, are known for their fanned fingers, as their common name describes, of course. It's these enlarged digital pads that they have that make them the most agile gecko species on these rocks. Among the geckos that live on the rocks around here, these are the largest, though I must point out that the one that we have here is not fully grown. This one that we have here is quite a good representation of the species because as far as pattern and color goes, it's quite average. But these can be pale to a point where they basically have no pattern, but they can also be darker, almost fully tan. We have a scorpion in the genus Buthacus down here in the sand. This is the most prevalent scorpion species in the dunes out here by far, especially as you get further in and there are less rocks. In many areas, this is the only species of scorpion that I come across for many hundreds of meters, which can be a little bit unfortunate considering how they do look fairly generic. In fact, I'm not even too interested in identifying which species of Buthacus this is. And there are several species around here, including Buthacus tagmorensis, Leptocheles, Arava, and Yodvatensis. There's also another species of Buthacus on the other side of the mountain that I also haven't identified. It looks quite similar, but doesn't live in the dunes. This is the lightest species of scorpion that lives out here. For me, it's been much easier to find them on the white sand instead of the redder sand, though this might be an illusion considering that they're a bit spotty. This one that we have here is an adult and likely a female, and most of the juvenile scorpions that I've been seeing around here have been of this species. We have an urchin beetle walking around down here in the sand. First one that I've seen since I've been here. In addition to being called the urchin beetle, these are also called radiant sun beetles, and both of these names are derived from the same morphological feature on this beetle, and that is these backwards-facing spines that they have on the distal margins of their elytra. While many other darkling beetles have a chemical spray, These instead defend themselves with the spines that they have on their legs. They track their predator with the point of their abdomen, and they use these spines on their legs to clasp or pinch the predator. If that fails, these backwards-facing serrations on their elytra are meant to make it difficult to swallow the beetle. On humans, this pinching method is capable of drawing blood. One of the reasons this defense is quite effective for this beetle is because of its size. Prionotheca coronata are some of the largest tenebrionid beetles, or darkling beetles, in the world. We have our third and final Orthochirus crawling around here on the rock. The stretch of habitat that's most auspicious for finding these scorpions around this mountain is actually quite thin. You might have noticed that these three scorpions that we found are in the areas where the sand is a little bit packed. This kind of habitat is most extensive and contiguous around the periphery of the mountain. But looking from the side of the mountain out to the open desert, there's only about a few meters of this kind of habitat. And that's where the vast majority of these Orthochirus like to hang out. This kind of crust most likely forms best when it has runoff water from the rocks, as well as additional protection from the wind. The closer I am to the rock, the more the habitat is colonized by Compsognathus, and the closer I am to the loose sand, the more it's colonized by Buthacus. But it does have a notable microsympatry with Androctinus, and I'm defining this microsympatry as the most likely scorpion to be found under a rock with Orthochirus. Last thing about this species, I'm sure people are wondering how toxic they are. The short answer is, it's not known. In fact, there's very little data on scorpion stings from the genus Orthochirus in general. That being said, there have been sting reports from Orthochirus and Nessie that have been described as painful, but to my knowledge, none have been deadly. But Orthochirus scorbiculosis from southern Iran has resulted in deaths in the past. Well, that is all of the Orthochirus, or pillar-tailed scorpions, that we are going to see in this desert tonight. So, hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.